life can be difficult for all animals, and that includes emotional difficulties, challenges when we become separated from someone we love, or someone we love is in pain or is dying. But I don't find that to be a depressing topic of research because of the fact that it's rooted in so much joy and love. We're paying much, much more attention to animals and asking those hard ethical questions. Whom should we be eating? Who should we be putting in theme parks? Who should we be putting in biomedical laboratories? So I see it all of a piece that the discovery process is scientifically important, but it's also important for all of us as a society.
Cover me when I run. Cover me through the fire. Something knocked me off the trees. Now I'm on my knees. Cover me. Darling, please, monkey, don't you know you're gonna shock monkey? Fox the fox, rat on the rat. You can ape the ape, I know about that. There is one thing you must be sure of, I can't take any more, darling. Don't you monkey with the monkey, monkey. You know you're gonna shock the monkey. Wheels keep turning. Something's burning. Cover me when I sleep. Cover me when I breathe. You throw your pearls before the swine. You make the monkey blind. Cover me, darling, please, monkey. Don't you know you're gonna shock the monkey? Watch the monkey get hurt, monkey. Watch the monkey get hurt, monkey. Jack the Monkey to life.
All right, welcome to the program, everybody. This is your host, Andy Gervich. We did not, I repeat, not win the Willamette Week's Best of Portland Podcast Reader's Choice Award for 2016. I wish I could offer you one of those statements that says it was an honor to be nominated, but that is bullshit. We wanted to win, and we are heartbroken that we did not. That's only partially true. It was an honor to be nominated. The show that won has been around for 7 years and has built quite a network and a following for itself. And we're new kids on the block still. So, you know, we're getting our voice out there. We're sharing our thoughts and bringing these guests to you who embody the spirit of this intersection of creativity and transformation. And we'll see where the show takes us. We're proud of where we've gotten in this first year. As we come up on a year of episodes, we're extremely happy with the guests we've had so far this summer. We look forward to growing with you, having our audience grow as the show grows, and we'll get back at it next year. You know, the desire to win that award is really tied to something I think that is connected to our guest this week. Our guest is Barbara J. King. She is Emerita Professor of Anthropology from the College of William and Mary and a freelance science writer. She does a lot of appearances on NPR talking about cool things like when Finding Dory and Finding Nemo comes out. She goes on the air and says, do not buy these fish for your children. They are basically harvested from the ocean and do all sorts of horrible damage to the ecosystem. And so Barbara's one of those folks that, you know, when irresponsible memes about Coco the monkey or about, you know, silverback gorillas in the zoo start circulating the internet, Barbara's one of those people who comes to the front to help us sort all this out and has been a lifelong, steadfast, articulate advocate for animals and animal welfare and animal emotions. And what her work has been focusing on of late is on exactly that, on animal emotions, animal behavior. We speak in the interview, and I've spoken before about Jeremy Rifkin's work in The Empathic Civilization and what he talks about us being softwired for empathic distress. These things called mirror neurons, our ability to empathize with another. This is a profound quality, and we think a unique quality of human experience, but we actually have found that dolphins feel this, elephants do, dogs, and we're trying to figure out how many other animal species do as well. And what's profound about this is that sense of empathy, right, can create a sense of community, right? When one empathizes with another, one feels one's pain as one's own, then suddenly one things like the golden rule in religion, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, the sort of reverse engineering of that starts to pop up. And things that we would consider to be uniquely human traits, human emotions, we suddenly start to see outside of the human family. And Barbara's work is fascinating for that, and it's a deep well of introspection and of work, and very articulate and very well researched findings into primate behavior and what they have to say, not just for what they have to say about the origins of human behavior or a connection to that, but what they have to say about the animals themselves. I love that about Barbara's work as well. It's not just a stepping stone. We don't study primates just so we can sort of pick through and find some things that might apply to human behavior and then move on. We study these noble beings in and of their own right and for their own integrity. And this movement towards recognizing the beings that we share the earth with as having agency and as being beings of moral capacity, or at least and of sharing these mirror neurons and empathic distress, is profound and interesting work. The book that drew me to her came from a conversation I had with a friend of the show, Lydia Yuknovich, the book Evolving God. And this book is a fantastic thesis. In it, Barbara talks about her research into primate behavior and makes a pretty profound suggestion that the root of the human religious impulse can be seen in primates, in this impulse we share to belong, this sense of community, this need for belonging. our sociability. And it got me to thinking of someone who's been a profound influence on me and my work over the years, the Benedictine monk David Stendhal Rost. And when he talks about what many psychologists call these peak experiences in our life, in religious terms, we would call these mystical moments or mystical experiences. And Stendhal Rost says that the mystical experience is often an awareness of being one with the ultimate, and I'm going to quote him here, a sense of limitless belonging to God, if you wish to use this term. Suddenly, for a brief moment, you feel no longer left out, as we so often do, no longer orphaned in the universe. It feels like a homecoming to where you belong. And his meditations, his work, centers on studying this notion of belonging. And he actually puts the religious impulse between these two poles on a continuum between longing and belonging, and centers the religious experience as he understands it on that continuum. But so much of what he says, and so much of what many of the mystics say, whether you're looking at Christian mystics, Jewish mystics, Islamic mystics, Buddhist mystics, across the board, Taoist, what they seem to be saying is that at that nexus, that intersection of transformation, when one goes into these states, what one starts to feel is a sense of profound connectedness, a sense of belonging to the very ground of being of the cosmos. And so I think Barbara's on to something, and I think it's really cool to start talking about how maybe it's not just people that share this impulse. You know, so much, I think, of our suffering on the planet comes from our need to isolate ourselves from one another. And when I look at so many things in my own life, from my own children, and looking at the things they're going through at the moment, and their successes, and the things that they're learning and growing into as people, and their struggles, excuse me, it makes me emotional. What I see in here is a deep sense of need for a sense of belongingness, first of belonging to one's self, and then a belonging to other. When I look at all the way from the micro in my own life, all the way to these horrific events that happened recently in Nice, whether you're the people gathering here for this festival on Bastille Day, a need to belong, a need to celebrate tradition, a need to come together in the public square to belong to one another, or whether you're the individual in the truck doing this horrific event. And we don't know full details about this person yet, but people that commit these events are also broken, isolated people that have a profound need to belong, and have satiated that need by belonging to radical religious movements, satiated that need by belonging to separatists, sects, and groups that seek to do harm to innocent people. Sometimes we don't satiate that need. We don't satisfy that need to belong with healthy things for ourselves and for others. And I think what mythological traditions can do when they're healthy, when they're functioning, when they're living in people's lives, is steer you away from the kind of destructive side of chasing this need, this deep cellular need we have to belong. Steering us away from the destructive impulse to satisfy that, and more towards a holistic impulse of satisfying that, of finding ourselves in other, of stoking that empathic distress, and of reaching this mystical awareness of oneness, and not oneness as a way to placate racial and gender and socioeconomic economic divides in our society, but actually using it as the template to create real change. To facilitate a very lived and felt and practical oneness, something we're very far from in this society and most on the planet at the moment. But that dialectic between the oneness of being that exists in the meditative states and that oneness of being that gets translated out into the political is the great dialectic of our time, and really of the past couple of ages. And I don't see that changing for the near future. But Barbara's work is compelling and fascinating because it moves it out of the human realm, this need for us to feel so special and so unique, and starts to look at some of the larger primate impulses of so much of what we do. Very happy to have her on the show, and I think you're going to really enjoy her. All right, folks, Barbara J. King coming up next for you. We're glad you're with us, and we will see you on the other side.
Welcome to On the Block with Andrew Gurvich, a podcast about authentic people doing beautiful things. Enjoy the show.
Welcome to the program, folks. This is Andy Gurvich, your host, and I'm very excited about our guest today. Barbara J. King is an emerita professor of anthropology at the College of William and Mary and a freelance science writer. Barbara's cat rescue work, which she shares with her husband, brings her happiness every day. I can't wait to get into that with her a little bit. She writes weekly for NPR's 13/7 Cosmos and Culture blog, and is author of the book Evolving God and several others that we're going to talk about, including How Animals Grieve and the forthcoming, what's the forthcoming title again, Barbara?
Personalities on the Plate, the Lives and Minds of Animals We Eat.
Oh, that sounds like a fascinating title as well. I can't wait to get into that with you. Barbara, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much, Andy. I'm really happy to be here.
You know, I'm so excited to speak with you for several reasons. I think I'm a professor of world religions and mythology, but I really think I'm a closet anthropologist, or I should have been one in another life. I became fascinated in Paleolithic and Neolithic religion several years ago through studying the likes of Maria Gimbutas and Joseph Campbell and several others, and with the discovery of the Chauvet Cave. I published an article about what I thought saw was the mythological implications of the art in Chauvet Cave, and kind of my theory on religion, which is that it's an algorithm for consciousness, for expanding symbolic consciousness. Through that work, kind of fell into in discussions with several anthropologists, especially folks studying the anthropology of consciousness. And so I love the work that you do. And I mean, is there anything better than studying anthropology?
I haven't found it, if there is. What I love about it so much is that we study human consciousness and, of course, the consciousness of other animals, too. And that's just what I love doing.
When I was speaking with a friend of mine, Brian Rill, who's the president of a group called the Society for the Anthropology of Consciousness, a group that I'm on the board, he told me that when folks go into anthropological study in undergraduate, everyone has to kind of study a kind of triad of anthropological study, and that's biological, cultural, and linguistic. Is that correct?
Well, in the United States, we tend to think of it as a quartet, which is biological, cultural, archaeology, and linguistics.
Oh, I left out archaeology.
I was raised on that four-field approach. That's certainly not the case in other countries necessarily, but it is a holistic and really comprehensive approach that appeals to me very much, and I've continued to work in the department for many years in which we do take that approach.
So when you, your particular work, that four-pronged approach, and then you pick an area of specialization, and for you, what was that? Where did you decide to specialize?
Yeah, well, back in my college days, I was heavily deciding that I would be a doctor, and I was convinced that I would be a neurosurgeon, and then I hit science and math courses, and that plan ended abruptly. So I stumbled into a course on biological anthropology, and my body, heart, and mind all lit up, and I haven't looked back since. Hmm. So I've been based in biological anthropology with a strong specialty for many years in primate behavior.
Primate behavior. The book that I'm most interested in talking with you about, and we'll get into it in a little bit, is Evolving God, because that's how I came to an awareness of your work, and it's the book I'm most familiar with. But I think first, can I ask you a few questions about the book, How Animals Grieve?
Yes, that's my most recent one that's actually published, so that would be fun and fine.
Yeah, absolutely. Great. So what's the premise of this book? I've read a bit of it and read and seen some interviews you've done on it, but I just want to give our chance to tell our audience what the big idea of the book is.
Well, interestingly enough, given what you've just said, it really emerged out of my work for Evolving God, and we'll get to that later, I know. But mm-hmm. One part of my work for that book was to really investigate what we know about human and human ancestral response to death. You know, what kind of mortuary rituals or death rituals might there be, and might they be linked to conceptions of an afterlife? And as I was compiling all of that research, it started to occur to me, well, I wanted to know about other species' response to death. At this time, I was doing a lot of work with chimpanzees, bonobos, and gorillas, our closest living relatives, and really beginning to understand for myself how deeply cognitive they are and how emotional they are. So I started out reading the literature on primate response to death, and I did find some very interesting hints of really rigorous grief, you know, that there's a body in a forest, not just in captivity, and the animals surround it and act in ways that seem to indicate some kind of mourning. So from there, I just wanted to do a broad survey and push beyond primates and elephants and cetaceans, what I call the big-brained sort of usual suspects for cognitive behavior. And I was really stunned because I found what I consider to be definitely credible evidence in a huge range of species for grief, ranging from farmed animals to domestic animals like cats and dogs, to a whole range of mammals and birds. And so I just fell into this, and it kind of goes along with my broadening of my own consciousness over the years from just the great apes and the monkeys to all these other species. So it's opened up my thinking in a great way.
Yeah, I think it's a fascinating idea because, you know, in my study of religious ideas throughout history, especially the Judeo-Christian systems, as late as the Middle Ages, there were philosophers that said, you know, a screaming animal was just a misfunctioning machine. And so this idea that any animals, including higher primates or higher thinking animals, when we're talking about elephants or dolphins or killer whales or other things, the fact that these animals would experience emotions at all was a controversial idea until quite recently. But, you know, you broadening that concept to include so many other animals, and I want to ask you about that in a minute. There's something that you said in the book that that says, okay, sure, the complexity of an animal's brain and the more we can associate it with consciousness, maybe we can associate the depth and complexity of grief there. But that doesn't mean that other organisms don't experience grief. Is that close to kind of one of the points you're making?
Yeah, that's it in a nutshell. What I want to really be saying with this book and with my work in general is, of course, there are human species-specific ways of grieving. I think we anticipate our own deaths and those of others, and we grieve across space and time in ways that are qualitatively quite different from other species. But love is love, and grief is grief. And I use those words full stop to apply to animals ranging from dairy cows to free-ranging elephants. And I don't think anymore that that's an unscientific program. I think that's in line with what we do know about animal emotion. So the elephant work is very much the ethological touchstone because we have very good data showing, for example, when one particular matriarch died in Samburu National Reserve in Kenya, there were representatives of five different elephant families that came and acted in ways that clearly showed distress and vigil type of behavior and grieving. And everybody is interested in that, but perhaps unsurprised by it. So the hypothesis from there then becomes, can we find anything like that in other species that in which we might not expect it? And, you know, there's really fascinating, tantalizing clues from Yellowstone National Park of bison who do things that are perhaps similar And then, as I mentioned, you know, I was just blown away by really convincing examples that range from geese and ducks to house cats.
I want to ask you to tell our audience the two ducks story that you've told in some of the promotional materials and interviews for that book. But before that, what you're just talking about reminds me of something I read in Jeremy Rifkin's great book about the empathic civilization, when he talks about the discovery of mirror neurons from that that study that was done in Italy when they had a macaw monkey hooked up to the MRI machine and was studying its brain as it was eating nuts. And then while they were on a break, the monkey was still hooked up to the machine. A human came in and eats one of the nuts. And the monkey's watching this intruder come and eat its food. And the same parts of its brain lit up as if it was eating the nut. And at first they thought the machine was malfunctioning. Then they realized that, they thought there's something wrong with the data here. But then because again, this assumption that an animal couldn't possibly feel empathy, right? Even in a scientific concept that was there. But so from that work, they've been able to determine that elephants, dolphins, maybe dogs, and the list keeps growing of what other animals have this empathic capacity. But what I'm getting from your book and your work is even animals, even if we can determine that a species doesn't have this mirror neuron complex, that doesn't mean that they're not able to experience grief.
Yeah, that's right. One of the books that I've read, reviewed, and enjoyed very much recently by Franz Duval is called Are We Smart Enough to Know How Smart Other Animals Are? Hmm. And I think that's an excellent question.
Wow.
And what it means is, of course, that we're not going to find out all this cool stuff if we don't ask the right questions and look with open eyes. And there's a lot of other scientists and animal activists engaged in that. But that's really how I define my job, is to try to spend some time, either personally or through the literature, really looking at what animals are doing. And, you know, it's not just looking at a photograph or a video clip. We all love all this viral animal stuff across the internet. But it's kind of resulted in a weird situation now where everything is grief or love or joy in the case of animals. And it's gotten to the point where I think it's becoming highly unscientific. And we need to remember that we're looking at complicated beings, and we need to look at them sort of before, during, and after whatever event it is that we're talking about, a birth, a death, some new social relationship. So I'm really happy that we're pushing the boundary. We're asking new questions and looking with new eyes, but we want to look also with, you know, scientific eyes. So
that's a fascinating, that leads me into actually two questions, and one of them is, can you tell our audience the two ducks story that you've told, I think, in the book and then in other places regarding this book?
Yeah, one of the most wonderful places to live if you are a farmed animal and a rescued one is in Watkins Glen, New York, at Farm Sanctuary. And the team at Farm Sanctuary took in at 1.3 rescued ducks. They were taken from a foie gras factory. And I'm sure your listeners know it's not a whole lot of fun for ducks to be in such a place because they're forced in order to fatten their liver, and they end up with lipidosis and all kinds of problems. So two of these three ducks that came to Farm Sanctuary were particularly in bad shape. Not only were they afraid of people, which is pretty darn understandable, but they had between them problems with vision and with their legs, and of course they had, you know, internal injuries. So they were being taken care of, and the two ducks bonded. They were named Harper and Cole. And they bonded with each other very, very closely, and they spent their time together. And after 4 years of a really good life on the sanctuary property, one of them had to be euthanized. It was at a point where his pain was really too great. So being really smart folks, the sanctuary workers decided to let his friend, the other one, observe the actual process in the body to understand what happened. Because, you know, if you're in a zoo or a sanctuary and you're an animal and you've got a really close friend, one day they're there, one day they're not. We don't know how they experience that sudden absence when a companion has died if they don't ever get to see the body. Mm-hmm. But by giving them the chance to see the body, there's at least a hope that there might be some recognition and some closure. And so there was the body of this one dead duck, and the other one came and draped himself across his friend, laid there for quite some time, some hours. And when the body was finally removed, from that point forward, the surviving duck was just clearly sad and depressed. And There's really no other word for it. And he would take himself to a small pond on the sanctuary property where the two had spent many of their hours together. And this was in social withdrawal and didn't bond with anybody. And eventually, and not too long later, he died as well. And that just kind of opened up, you know, in the beginning of my research, opened up my thinking process. Would I really have considered that to be so possible with ducks before I started? I'm not so sure, and I certainly do now. And it requires me not to come to research on really any animal with preconceived notions.
It's so fascinating. And, you know, when we start looking around and, as you say, asking the right questions, we can kind of see this stuff everywhere. I remember seeing actually not so recently now, that movie Blackfish about the killer whales in captivity. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that really struck me in the film was the thing about the dorsal fins on all of the males being flopped over in captivity. And how they say there's no explanation for that. But I think there's a pretty clear explanation for that. This is a clear sign of stress and of grief.
Yeah, and in fact, it's so great that you bring up blackfish and that whole sort of issue of animal welfare, animal rights to some, animal welfare to others, because the underlying motivation and drive of my work is two-pronged. One is scientific curiosity about the natural world and the world that we all live in, and the other is once I derive what I consider to be really good evidence for some kind of animal emotional response, I want to always ask, well, what does that mean for how we treat animals? You know, it's not just, okay, I'm going to write a book and put it on the shelf, hope to sell some copies and talk about it. It's like, what do we do now?
Right.
Now that we know that animals in laboratories or theme parks or zoos or what have you are feeling these emotions, it's not only at the point of death, but it's also at the point of separation or the point of stress. So we know that in theme parks, you know, these orcas or other dolphins, they're separated from their families either when they're captured or when they're made to perform. Or, you know, I could go on with my examples, but the idea is that what happens to one individual radiates out sort of in these concentric circles of felt emotion throughout family and kin, just as it happens with us. And that, once you start thinking about that and thinking, you know, what you're doing when you go to a particular place for entertainment or, you know, who you put on your plate, you start realizing that you're, you know, eating beings who really feel their lives as well as think about their lives.
Is that what you mean when I've heard you say that you wrote that book in particular and probably the one that's coming because the animals were telling you that you needed to write a book about animal grief? Is that kind of what you meant by that?
Well, you know, I kind of borrowed from a colleague and friend and brilliant writer, Mark Beckoff, the idea that the animals, he says sometimes, around him in Colorado are telling him, what are you doing, Mark? Taking a day off. Let's get with it. There's things to be doing. And I think, you know, anyone who is closely tied to a particular cause that we interpret as social justice feels an urgency, and so I'm just part of that same network of everybody who's working on something that matters to them deeply.
What do you say to the folks that, you know, just to follow up on this SeaWorld and zoo thing, and maybe we'll talk about the silverback incident here as well, probably get into the Evolving God stuff in the second segment, but what do you say to folks that say, you know, zoos or these theme parks exist to introduce people to these animals, and that produces in them an awareness and a consciousness that translates into a conservation consciousness, that if it weren't for zoos and these places, people wouldn't be able to come into contact with these animals and thus not form relationships with them, which translate into wanting to protect them in the wild?
Well, yes. Okay, here are a couple things that I would say in response. One is that if that's your platform and premise, then basically you're asking the animals who live in zoos to be ambassadors, right? They're the ones who are supposed to turn you on to wildlife and conservation education. But meanwhile, those individuals, there's a severe cost to their lives because they're living in very unnatural ways. So that's a problem for me.
Sure.
Second, the idea that, you know, people are going to fall in love with species in the zoo is not really borne out by the science that I'm reading. Of course it happens in individual cases. We can all probably point to public figures or friends of ours who had some kind of moving experience in a zoo. It happens. But across the board, people are not really reporting that they're A, spending a whole lot of time at each quote-unquote exhibit, or B, exiting the zoo with a whole lot of new information.
Sure.
And then the other thing is, when you go to a zoo, let's say you're looking at predators. Well, you know, in the U.S., at least, predators really aren't allowed to be predators. I mean, they certainly can't hunt naturally in their enclosure. And why? Well, it's not just the size of the enclosure. It's we don't want to upset the public. You know, I was reading a really good book by sociologist David Braben, and it's called American Zoo. I hope I pronounced his name correctly. Mm-hmm. And he was saying that at a zoo where he was working as a sort of academic, you know, ethnographer, if you will, there was a code set of numbers whenever an animal died. Like, they'd say, okay, Stanley, the such-and-such species, 2146, and people would run, because they don't want anyone in the zoo to become upset by death, by hunting. So you're not seeing real-life examples of animals acting in natural ways. And the last thing I would say is that we need to trust the public a little more and suggest that there are other ways to experience wildlife. You know, for people who perhaps can't get to our parks for any number of reasons, or overseas to Africa, there's virtual reality, there's all kinds of wonderful documentaries, there are sanctuaries that would say have once a month or once a year the possibility of visiting. People can get turned on by these things without getting a benefit at a zoo that ends up costing another sentient animal quite a lot.
Yeah, it's such a bizarre, I mean, I really think you said it well there. It's such a bizarre thing to say. It's like saying we should reinstitute slavery and then have folks in theme parks as slaves so we can show people the evils of slavery or something. You know what I mean? It's kind of a self-defeating argument.
That's definitely a self-defeating argument. You got it.
Yeah, this recent controversy and tragedy with this child that fell into the enclosure with the silverback, was that the Cleveland Zoo, I believe?
It was Cincinnati Zoo.
Cincinnati.
And it was a 17-year-old male Harambe.
I loved your take on this because you said something very similar. You said instead of asking, you know, about these bad parents and this bad mother and why was the child allowed near the gorilla, you were asking essentially why is there a gorilla near where children are? Or in other words, why aren't we asking the question of why we have an animal like this in an enclosure like this to begin with?
Yes, just a short while ago, I had a very interesting conversation about Harambe and the events surrounding his death on the Diane Rehm show with Dennis Kelly, who's the director of the National Zoological Park in Washington, and Andrew Rifkin, who's the Blue Dot blogger from the New York Times. And, you know, we were talking about some of these questions about the pros and cons, costs and benefits of zoos. And the very good thing about that, although I certainly disagreed quite a bit with Director Kelly, I appreciated his input, was that we're having that conversation now. And I'm so sorry that Harambe had to die because of it. I've always said that it's a big mistake to second-guess the zoo workers on that day. I would never do that. All the zoo people I've ever worked with have been kind, caring, compassionate people, and I think they did the best they could. But the question has to be a larger one. Is there a way that we can shift the ratio of zoos to sanctuaries in this country and start housing our animals in different ways and not simply breeding them over and over and over again to restock our zoos, which is a very circular argument?
You know, one of the things that I think is fascinating as well in what you bring up is I have some friends, I'm thinking of my friend Tina Fields and others who work at Naropa and other places that are eco-psychologists, and one of the things they've really been pushing recently is this concept of there is no away, you know, this idea of we throw something away and it doesn't go away. When we throw plastic away, it ends up in the Pacific, and, you know, things that have been landfills that leach into groundwater. And so there is no away. And I think one of the problems of modern civilization as a whole, and in America in particular, is this idea that nature and the natural world is something out there. And I think even zoos continue that notion, that concept, that nature is something we go to, we go away to, we go and visit, and then come back from. And I think the consciousness that needs to start spreading in our species is that we're never not in nature.
Well, that's a really beautiful point, and I'd like to ask you after to get a reference to read about the away work.
Sure.
You know, because, right, a zoo is a bounded place. You go in and you go out, and then you've been to nature. And one thing that I've been doing just in the last year or two with my husband, we live quite near Yorktown, Virginia, is just spending a lot of time walking, not only just over the sort of historical battlefields, which are interesting, but there's a number of sort of back roads with ponds and swampy areas, and this is like right near my house. I spend time there, and I really realize that, you know, nature is around me. I go into my yard and I just sit and I look at the dragonflies. We had a coyote, which was a bit startling, in our yard this week. And, you know, I'm trying to realize more and more that when I write about nature, it's not just because I've been to Amboseli National Park in Kenya or Yellowstone National Park in Wyoming. It's because I'm here, you know,
there,
in
yeah.
my town.
You
exactly.
live in it. My wife Celeste, who's also the associate producer of this show, is a bird lady, and she, you know, as we are hiking, she calls out to them and sounds like a maniac to the other people hiking. But of course, then all the birds show up, and she's been able to teach me several of their calls. So now I understand when I hear a chickadee call or a flicker call. And I can tell you, it's just blown open my consciousness and my awareness of what's around me, too. Because prior to that, you know, when I would be hiking, I would, you know, it would all just be bird noise, right? I would hear sort of these calls and they would be indistinguishable. Or because they were indistinguishable, sometimes I would tune them out entirely. But now that I can pick them out, it just not only enhances my experience, but my awareness of where I am and the fact that there's interspecies communication. When my wife starts talking to chickadees, they talk back, right? It actually happens. I've watched it with my own eyes, and it's a really remarkable thing to see. And again, we don't have to go anywhere for that. We can do that in our own backyard.
Well, that sounds ultimately great. I love that idea. And what you're describing is kind of what happened to me when I, you know, started my field work. I was in Kenya to study baboons, and I just was the greenest person. I knew nothing, and there were Kenyan assistants who, of course, walked out into the savannah and saw so much, and I'm basically stumbling from, you know, place to place, and I did learn. You can learn. But one of the problems that relates to that with the zoos is that, you know, if I have worked, and I did do consulting, scientific filming and observing for a long time, in zoos, I sit there, and because I know the relationship among the animals and how they've been together and how they relate and what their histories are, you know, what I'm seeing is completely different than what someone who just walks up to the zoo is seeing, not because I'm better or smarter, but because I know the histories. And zoos don't tell people that, right? They might have a plaque that tells you names and dates and ages.
Sure, sure.
And that's it. And so, you know, we have to do better. We're not giving that kind of, you know, mind-opening experience in any way when we're confining these animals.
You know, you bring something interesting up, and let me maybe this ask you this one last question before we go to break. When you talk about the study of baboons in your work, and it actually leads me to something I was about to ask you anyway, so I can combine the questions, and that has to do with, you know, the popularizing of some of this study that has brought sort of international attention to some of these issues, but sometimes with some flawed science. And so my colleague Chris Ryan told me about, because there's been a lot of sort of faulty assumptions made from faulty work in the study of primate behavior to try to explain human behavior. And so Margaret Mead talked about how, you know, the angry chimp theory explaining human warfare is a problematic thing. And Chris told me about a study that was done on baboons in England in the late 1800s. And you can maybe correct me if I'm wrong here. I love being proven wrong on the show. Happens all the time. That there was an English scientist who brought a bunch of baboons to a facility in England and studied them. And then what they started, you know, all of a sudden, overnight or after a week or so, they started coming back in the morning and finding several of the males had been killed. And this happened again and again and again. And then they drew some conclusions from this that baboons were violent and territorial and killed other males for females. But the problem was is that they hadn't realized how baboons live in the wild, which is that how they actually organize is there's usually one male for several females, and then they spread out in groups to where there's not that kind of competition. And it leads, so I guess question A, is that correct? And you can maybe comment on that. And then the second part of the question has to do with so-called Leakey's angels, Jane Goodall, Diane Fossey, and Baruti Galdikas, and their work because on one side of the coin, you know, this was a fascinating thing Leakey did. It brought, again, international attention to the study of hominids and their national environments. But the other side is there were some flaws in their work, and some pretty serious one. I'm thinking about, again, the Goodall study with the bananas, and you put a giant box of Chiquita bananas on the ground and then see how the chimps behave and then record those results as if they are natural behavior, when, of course, this you know, this mother load of bananas is not something that they would have come across normally. And so that changes everything in terms of the experiment. Does that make sense? Can you maybe speak to both of those?
Well, I'll try. I believe what Chris Ryan is saying, and shout out to Chris, whose work I love, is a study by Solly Zuckerman, probably at the London Zoo,
yes.
And I would have to reread that, probably. You know, a lot of baboons, including the ones that I studied in Kenya, are multi-male, multi-female, but I believe in this study, and I honestly would feel better if I could somehow check, is that there was a one-male unit, and so it was a complete mismatch between natural history, in that case, and housing conditions. And I think that that's a good caution, somewhat of less of a concern, because I will say that certainly, you know, zoo biologists nowadays are, you know, pretty careful about that kind of thing. I think it's more of a philosophical difference at zoos rather than necessarily a lack of scientific knowledge, which would lead us in a different direction. As far as Goodall, Fossey, and Galdikas are concerned, I really have to just give them, from, you know, the very big part of my response, a lot of admiration, because I think Jane Goodall, you know, you have to realize that in 1960, no one had done a long-term study of chimpanzees before. It is certainly true that Japanese primatologists had done quite a lot of fascinating work on monkeys that gets overlooked. You know, we tend to say, oh, the start of long-term field primatology was with Jane Goodall. Not so at all. There were concepts of society and relationship coming from the Japanese that were incredibly foundational. But in any case, she was still an early pioneer. And I think what happened with the banana provisioning was quite understandable in historical light. And it stopped, you know, relatively quickly. The fact that Jane Goodall opened really the world's eyes to individual differences among animals, you know, that she named, she refused to give numbers, she talked about having personalities, she highlighted. So some mothers are good and some mothers are bad. Some male chimpanzees are status driving, some are not. That work to me had so much benefit that it kind of overshadows what were some problems, some methodological problems. So I'll give you the fact that there were problems, but I would look to the benefits. And if I could just say one last thing.
Sure.
It bothered me greatly at the start of my scientific career to read that if, let's say, there was an ill chimpanzee and Jane Goodall's team thought they could help that chimpanzee, they would intervene in some way, perhaps by giving a vaccine. And I thought at the time that that was incredibly interventionist in the way that was anti-science. And as I've changed my focus from working on animals to working with and for animals, I see the beauty of that. She would stand up and say, look, you know, we screwed up this habitat in a lot of ways. We are pressing these animals and causing all this habitat trouble. So if there's some way in which we can do some good, you know, I'm going to put that first ahead of the science. And now I think that's completely brilliant.
That's so great to hear. And for the notion, or again, let me start that again. In full disclosure, I'm a huge fan of all three of those women, and I just didn't want to say that with the question because I wanted to give you a chance to speak to the science. I think, and we'll go to break after this. What they did for women in the sciences cannot be underestimated. You know what I mean? And I bet a lot of folks' careers were instigated because of the example that the three of them set. Jane Goodall continues to do fascinating work. So does Galdikas, right? Isn't she still
very much
in country? And then Diane Fossey died in service of these animals. And so hats off to all three of them in terms of their service, their sacrifice, and in two of their cases, their continued work, right? And it goes beyond just working with primates.
Absolutely.
Fascinating stuff. Well, we're going to go to break, and when we come back, I want to talk to you about Evolving God. I want to talk to you about the new book and a little bit about bonobos. Is that all right with you?
That That sounds good, Andy.
All right. You're listening to On the Block Radio, folks. Our guest is the anthropologist Barbara J. King, and we will be right back after these words.
Listening to On the Block Radio, the seventh coolest podcast about consciousness on the internet. We'll be right back.
The A word. I have been every day, probably for the last 10 years, someone has come up to me and said, but what about anthropomorphism? What is anthropomorphism? It's the projection of human qualities onto animal lives. And what is really meant by that typically is the inappropriate projection. In other words, we have to be really careful that we don't just decide that what we feel in a certain context, an animal might feel in that context. Point taken. But I'd ask you a question. What makes, for example, love, sadness, grief, joy, what makes them human qualities? Why would we start from the position that they are ours to decide whether other animals have or not, and that other animals only have them if they're like us? Maybe we could flip that around and think differently about the animal kingdom and think that maybe these are very widespread emotions. In 1872, Darwin published this book, The Expression of the Emotions in Man and Animals. So you can see that is quite a while after his famous On the Origins. He is very interested in looking at a wide variety of animals because he thinks he's seeing joy and sadness and fear and grief. He commissioned drawings of the animals that he was looking at, and he used words very freely without worrying about whether they belonged to our species only. He has this drawing of the dog in this book and refers to this as a benevolent dog. He has a drawing of this monkey and says the monkey is pleased. In the case of the juvenile chimpanzee, he uses the word sulky and disappointed. This is a pout face. Well, Darwin, as I mentioned, didn't just rely on the writings of others. He went to observe animals and look at them in various contexts. This is well after the voyage of the Beagle. And in the 1830s, he went to London Zoo to look at an orangutan that had been acquired there. And in his notebook, this is what he wrote. Let man visit orangutan in domestication, hear expressive whine, see its intelligence when spoken to, as if it understands every word said. See its affection to those it knew, see its passion and rage, sulkiness and very actions of despair, and then let him boast of his proud preeminence. Man in his arrogance thinks himself a great work, worthy the interposition of a deity, more humble and, I believe, true to consider him created from animals. So in the 19th century, there was intense interest in animal emotion. And we certainly don't have time to do a historical primer here. But I will tell you that that interest was soon overtaken by very hardcore skeptics who were extremely uncomfortable with using the words thinking and feeling in connection to animals at all. And this study very much fell out of favor for a long time. There is a renaissance now of studying animal thinking and feeling. It is part of this critical animal turn, we call it in the academy, the idea that we're seeing animals in a new light. We're understanding that they feel their lives profoundly, that they do think, that using these words to describe what they do is absolutely appropriate and not a projection.
Gonzalez, and you're listening to On the Block Radio with Andy Gurvich.
All right, welcome back to the program, folks. This is your host, Andy Gurvich, and we are speaking with the anthropologist Barbara J. King. And when we went to break, we were talking about Louis Leakey and the quote-unquote Leakey's angels, Jane Goodall, Diane Fossey, and Bruti Galdikas. And I wanted to just, I guess, ask you one more thing about that before we go on to some other stuff. My understanding of why Leakey made that choice at the time. And again, everything always has to be understood, you know, as a product of its time. And I think even some of those early mistakes that early anthropologists and biological anthropologists were making when they were studying primates in those conditions were corrected after, you know, after they were figured out, right? I mean, these are people that were sort of developing a field in the late 1800s. But I think Leakey had a good observation, and again, add to this or correct me if your understanding of it is different, but that he said by picking, you know, some folks who, you know, younger women, right, that they hadn't been trained in a field that was going to tell them what they were supposed to be looking for. And so they once you go through that process, then you become schooled in the field and in the knowledge where it is and the things you're supposed to be looking for and how you're supposed to see those things and how you're supposed to record them. And more importantly, you then are cut off from all of the things you might have observed before you were told that you couldn't observe those things. And in particular, these dynamics and family relationships. And then the second part was he thought women would be better observers of those family dynamics than men were. And is that correct? Were those his assumptions? And do you agree with them if those were his assumptions?
You are correct on both counts. Those were Louis Leakey's assumptions, both about lack of experience and secondly about gender. I'm all for the first one. I think it paid off, you know, spectacularly, the fact that each of these three women went to the field without having, you know, banged into them in graduate school that there's one way to do things,
sure,
which certainly, you know, was the case with me. My dissertation committee, which is a wonderful group of individuals from whom I learned a lot, were just horrified that I wanted to include some anecdotal information along with statistics about the baboons. I wanted to talk about individual baboons instead of aggregate baboons. And even at this time, which was the late 80s, it was still frowned upon. And, you know, I was kind of stuck there. So I get what he was doing. The second point about gender strikes me still as, you know, even with historical eyeglasses on, if you will, somewhat problematic, because he was saying women can do this better. And whenever you make an a priori judgment along the lines of gendered skills, I think it can be rightly interpreted as fairly sexist.
Yeah, that it rings that way, doesn't it? Even those positive kinds of stereotypes are limited. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Exactly, because why? I mean, I don't know that he was actually saying something like, well, women are closer to nature, men are closer to culture, which would certainly be sexist. But there had been, in his thinking, some set of assumptions that women would be better at something. Well, in fact, I mentioned in the first part of our talk, the Japanese scientists who uncovered so much about monkey society and monkey culture in the 1950s before Jane Goodall. And, you know, they were overwhelmingly male. I'm not saying that that was a great thing that they were overwhelmingly male, but they were. And they had tremendous insight into all kinds of dynamics in really sophisticated ways. So I actually think that Leakey was wrong on that point, but in a way that certainly benefited all of us, both in science and also in society.
Fascinating. You know, it also kind of reinforces a gender binary and all of those kinds of harmful notions that, you know, men are rational, women are emotional, you know what I mean? Those kinds of things that were still floating around very much in the late 60s and really still up to this day.
Yeah, I've actually just retired from William & Mary. I taught a course called Evolutionary Perspectives on Gender, and we talked about these very issues. And of course, you know, if you want to go a little bit further, we can get into the very question of a binary at all, since I think that there are more than two genders. Often this has been recognized not only by anthropologists, but by cultures throughout millennia all over the world. Mm-hmm. So because of this, and because I am lucky enough to have a daughter, Sarah Hogg, who is a queer feminist activist, I think in very different terms about even hearing male and female anymore, because that doesn't really quite do it, right? That doesn't quite capture the variety of experiences that we as people have.
Yeah, I saw a documentary about these creatures, these worms in the bottom of the ocean, that when they encounter one another, each of them has a semen sac in the forehead, and they kind of have this duel. And whichever one is able to strike the other one impregnates the one. And at that point, it's determined which one is the quote unquote mother.
The natural kingdom is absolutely fascinating in terms of its variability. And in my class, we talk mostly about people, and we talk about you know, of course, now it's very commonplace in the media to discuss transgender issues, and we are getting better at understanding, to some degree, the experiences of trans folks. But it's still not so common to understand about intersex, for example, or intersex individuals, where, you know, to ask the question, are you man or woman, do you identify as man or woman, may work for some folks, and it may not work at all for others. And I just think that that whole set of questions, which I realize is going a bit far afield from Lewis Leakey, are just really fascinating for anthropologists. And for anybody, for all of us.
I absolutely agree. You know, I have a friend who's taking classes. I'm a college professor, and I have friends that are college teachers, that are college administrators, and even students at different schools. And I have a friend who's taking classes at another university here in town, and she was blowing off some steam on social media the other day about an anthropology professor, and I obviously won't name the person that she was taking a class from, and she was saying she can't believe this person. He keeps they were talking about bonobos, and he keeps calling he keeps referring to the women.
The women
do this, the men do this, and she said it was like a couple of folks even corrected him a few times and said, you mean the females? Mm-hmm. And he was like, yeah, sure, yeah, the women. Anyway, and he keeps going, this is a person with a PhD in anthropology. And to not know the difference between those two terms when applying it to a primate community is really profound.
It is profound. And then I also think about, again, a lesson learned from my daughter, who just did a really cool webinar last night about the intersection of reproductive rights issues and trans rights issues. Mm. When we talk about women's health, for example, that term can even be very unintentionally exclusive, because we tend to think of what we define as quote-unquote biological females, but we all know that gender does not equate or compress or reduce to biology. And so the terms we use, you know, we really have to think about, who do we mean by women? How can we be inclusive of all people? And that's just a fascinating project.
It is fascinating. In my work, and you are right to say that we, you know, those of us that, you know, myself, at least I'll speak for me, you know, from, you know, my education was during the Neolithic. And so that's why I feel so prepared to talk about it. But I was speaking with some folks in the trans queer community recently about the things that I study, and in particular, gods and goddesses. And I was talking about goddess architecture and how historically the goddess is, and I'm not telling you or our audience anything you don't already know, but associated with fertility and regeneration, and cycles of nature, and a lot of different things, right? And how this birthing motif, this bringing forth of life, is something that has been, for our species, historically associated with women, thus the goddess concept. And the conversation went into some really interesting places with this community, because they were saying, you know, hang on now, what about women, identified women or females that don't reproduce? Or another person said, hang on a second, my boyfriend's pregnant. And everyone goes, wait a minute, what? Right. But then, you know, we have to allow for that is the wrong terminology. Our symbol system, our myths, our metaphors have to be expansive enough to start including those aspects of human communities, because all of that is the human experience. And anything that any symbol system, at least to me, that excludes that or sets it apart as somehow inauthentic or less authentic than any other expression of human identity or human love, I think is archaic at this point.
I agree with you. I like the sort of turning that on authenticity, because I think you're absolutely right.
Well, I love being right, but more importantly, I think, I think it's important for us to have those conversations. And I also have learned to appreciate being wrong in those kinds of dialogues when a member of one of those communities can actually show me where my experience or my privilege is kind of left me a blind spot or two. And so I think.
Oh, yeah. I mean, part of the joy of teaching that course is just sometimes shutting up and letting people who are in the community say, okay, you know, let me tell you something, and very, very collegially and politely, but yeah, bring it on.
Our friend Lydia Yuknovich teaches me about that all the time. I'm always going to her going, what do I do to help people of color? What do I do to help women? What do I do to help trans community? And she goes, you know, shut up and listen. It would be a good place to start. And I go, all right, Lydia, you're right. thanks
Not
for
only do I read Lydia's books just to sort of light up my life, but just on a daily basis, I go to Facebook and I read what she writes or see her pictures of the ocean and swimming and being an ocean mammal and her incredible championing of other people who write. Yeah, it works for me.
I saw a funny tweet from the philosopher Slavoj Zizek. He was writing to Werner Herzog, right? They have this funny thing back and forth online where they tweet each other. And he put a picture up of a still frame from Finding Dory. And he says, you are correct, Werner. This film does not show the true horrors of ocean life.
I like it.
Actually, let me ask you about that, because you published something, and then I'm just enjoying kind of shooting the breeze with you, but I do have some more questions, I guess.
Yes.
You talked recently about Finding Dory and sort of the controversy around that, and I wonder if you could maybe speak to that a little bit, about what it is you put in your NPR blog and what your concern is with this film and sort of our response to it.
Yes. In fact, the NPR editors at National Public Radio had asked me if I wanted to write about Finding Dory just before the movie opened, which I believe was 2 weeks ago now. Yeah. And really, the problem comes down to the fact that a lot of folks in this country, if they see an animal on screen on a major blockbuster movie, end up wanting to own the animal. And we've seen over time with any number of dogs, cats, other species, this idea of going out and owning. And so the Pacific blue tang is the fish that Dory is in this movie. And there's great concern that people will really deplete the numbers of this fish, taking them from the wild as pets or more likely from unscrupulous pet dealers, and really hurt, the ocean ecosystem and hurt these individual fish. And so I was just kind of pointing out, I did a series of posts for NPR about, if you're in the wild, maybe don't take the selfie with the bison or the grizzly, or take the bison and put it in your car if you think the bison is cold, because the animals always
pay. Poor baby,
Yeah, the animals always pay the cost, and it's the same thing. You know, if you go to a movie, have a great time, enjoy the movie, it doesn't mean necessarily that you have to, go out and own a wild animal. In fact, I read that there are scientists working in labs around the world who are just trying to raise captive Pacific blue tang to supply what will inevitably be the need so that people don't take them from the ocean. And, wow.
And so far, they haven't been able to do that, right? Successfully.
Right. Well, I'm not sure. Not sure where it stands now. But this was a cautionary tale for all of us. I all the time have to check myself. It's not just that I'm telling other people, what am I eating? Where am I going? I just want to be thoughtful about things.
Two questions that are kind of hangers on from the previous segment, if you don't mind me bouncing around a little bit before we jump into the Evolving God stuff as we finish.
Okay.
The discovery of bonobos, which was in the early 90s, is that correct?
Well, the discovery was in the 1920s, and we knew at that point there were two different species of Pan troglodytes. Chimpanzee and Pan Paniscus the bonobo, but the actual work to study them in the field started in the
1970s. Okay, so that's, in either case, that's really not that long ago.
No, that's right, it's not.
And how has their discovery, or more importantly, the work that's being done on them since the 70s, how has that changed our understanding of our own evolutionary path?
Well, one thing that's been very interesting to consider is the fact that if you look at the great apes, and you exclude the bonobo for the moment, you think about gorillas, chimpanzees, and orangutans, in some way, there's the fact of male aggression. In orangutans, it's very common for fully adult males to hold a female and force her to have intercourse. In gorillas, there's male infanticide often at the takeover of a new group, so that infants are killed, new baby infants of a mother. in chimpanzees, there's incredible violence of males towards females, and there's rarely, oh, there are exceptions, but most males are dominant over most females. And so that leads to a pretty bleak look at not our past, because we didn't evolve from apes, but at our past if these apes clue us in to what our ancestors were like, and that's a big question. So then you put bonobos into the picture, and wow, things are different. There's certainly females who ally with each other. They gang up. They fight back against males. A very different social structure. The males, in many cases, tend to hang out with their moms for very many years. The females have a lot of power. So I think it just broadens our conception of the way that our past may have been. And I certainly do want to caution that none of us in anthropology is suggesting that we need to make one-to-one models and say, oh, look, you know, our past was like this ape A or this ape B. But because we don't know, and we do tend to look at our closest living relatives, well, we can say, you know, there's no necessary path or trajectory through incredible male aggression to the present. It's not fixed, it wasn't determined, that kind of thing.
Yeah, and I think that is what fascinates me so much. And for our last little bit here, if you don't mind, a few questions about Evolving God. What I love about the book and about the premise is that in my work, in the study of religion, so just a few things about what I do, you know, I've been fascinated. I was trained as an evangelical pastor and practiced as a teaching pastor for several years. And so my initial training was in the monotheisms, but then had a kind of transformative experience of my own and walked away from those traditions. And as an academic, then started studying earlier traditions and started going back into the sort of origins of civilization and looking at the religious trajectories there, looking back into the Neolithic and the Paleolithic. And over the past 20 years, some amazing work has been done in this area. And there's so much that we had assumed that is turning out to not be correct. And, you know, Chris has done some good work on this. I've published a few things on it. A lot of folks are really doing wonderful work. And we go back and we look at the very, very beginning of civilization and prior to it. And when we find people in the Neolithic and in the Paleolithic, we find from what we can tell, we're always working with a kind of limited record and with the evidence we have. And we have to be careful, as you just said, to not try to make the evidence say too much. But what we have and what folks like Marieg and Buddhas point out is, you know, through the Neolithic, we don't have evidence of large scale warfare. We don't have evidence of Neolithic communities having much of a difference in terms of division of wealth. Grave sites weren't different in terms of size and complexity. And there seemed to be a partnership model that exists really from, you know, all the way up to that we can tell. Şatıl Hayek and Göbekli Tepe in Turkey. So it's really in Sumer when things start to change. And I find this fascinating for a lot of reasons, and this leads to my question. One of the things that we've been overturning a lot recently is our assumptions about Neanderthal complexity. And I'm thinking specifically about these stone circles that were found deep in caves in southern France that were created by Neanderthals and are dating back to 175,000 years. Mm-hmm. So what everyone's looking for in the study of religion and in the study of consciousness and mythological consciousness is, when did the on switch come on? Because if we believe that we are that we share a common ancestor with these primate relatives, and we as scientists and as people, you know, believe in our own human evolution, the theory is at some point in time we developed the capacity to start believing in God and thinking about God, that there was a day, right, or a period or a time when the switch came on, and everyone's looking for it. I even published when the Chauvet Cave article that I wrote that was in Popular Archaeology, which is a joke because I'm not popular nor an archaeologist, but you know, the article had a ridiculous title, like The Birth of Mythological Consciousness, or, you know what I mean, because I just wanted to sell the thing. But where everyone's looking for the smoking gun for when this began, and we can't find it. And one of the reasons maybe we can't find it is because your theory is that this capacity has always been there in one form or another. And so can you speak to us maybe about just what the premise of Evolving God is, what the big idea the book is trying to get at?
Yeah, I just wanted to look for the deepest roots of the human religious imagination, really, in other species. Because at that time, when I was writing this book, there was such a huge, seductive, and sexy push to look for religion in the genes, to look for religion in the brain module, to find, you know, the biological seat of religiosity. And that just, as an anthropologist, to me, that just seemed to be kind of missing a huge amount of material. So I put out this idea in the book that we really need to look at what I just call belongingness. And belongingness is just really the need to matter to other people, the collectivity, the mutuality, the way that we as primates create meaning with each other is really, to me, the roots of religion. So what I did is I looked to see what are the building blocks of what later became religion in, say, great apes. So my argument is not that great apes are spiritual or religious, although I would like to come back to that with an asterisk, if I might.
Sure.
But rather that we can see in them consciousness, rule following, some kind of ritual, imagination, and empathy, and that taken together, that was a platform. And as our own lineage began to evolve, you know, the whole 6 million years of our human lineage, as we were responding to climate change and social complexity, and our brain was complexifying and our brain size was increasing, that slowly our consciousness did begin to expand and began to take into account forces that are not visible or in the here and now, and that we began to create in our minds these very complicated thoughts about spirituality, supernatural issues, and the sacred, but that it's all rooted in sort of collective meaning-making. And, in fact, I'd love to ask you what you think about Göbekli Tepe, because that, of course, is headlined as, right, the first temple, the first place where people who were hunter-gatherers came onto this hill in Turkey and had collective meaning-making and collective ritual around these animal-inscribed pillars, and that it was all very sacred and all very supernatural. And you start getting a material culture record, maybe with the art caves of Western Europe and the art of Africa. But, you know, I wanted to take that into account, but I also wanted to look more at what isn't tangible, what isn't in the material culture record, and that is all the sociality.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Go ahead. I'll be happy to speak to your Göbekli question, but talk about that, though, the non-material culture roots of this concept, because that's one of the things I find most fascinating as somebody who's devoted themselves to looking at the material side of religious traditions, especially these artifacts and this art.
So if we look, you brought up Neanderthals, which of course is absolutely, you know, the right thing to do. We know that Neanderthals lived in social groups. We know that they did, in some cases, bury their dead intentionally. One of the things I do in the book is really take a look at what these burials were like. I mean, they involved marking the grave with animal bones. And in some cases, for example, in France 65,000 years ago, you know, really some built structures, not as fantastic as the find you just, you know, talked about, the one we just discovered 175,000 years ago, but built structures.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it's great to focus on and sort of catalog all the material culture, but what I want to do is think about what were the people, the Neanderthals, doing. And Steve Mitten, you know, wrote a fantastic book about Neanderthals dancing and singing that he thinks you can really analyze their caves and cave structure to suggest that they were using ritual spaces coming together for meaning making. And all of that sort of kind of thing really means that you could almost collectively, through rhythmic behavior and artistic meaning making, start expanding consciousness, you know, with or without drugs, who knows, to think about beyond the here and now. And that's the kind of thing that fascinates me. The asterisk that I mentioned earlier was just in the last year, there's been a huge renaissance, and you probably know all about this, Andy, of asking whether chimpanzees are or aren't spiritual. And there's a new book by Donovan Schaefer out of Oxford called Religious Aspects that's quite fascinating for making an argument that we need to stop thinking about religion as uniquely human. I don't necessarily agree with him, but he makes a fascinating and quite scholarly argument that when chimpanzees do come together and they're rhythmically swaying and dancing and very excited at a waterfall or something like this, that they are engaging in religion, and we can only notice that if we kind of take away this overlay of language and text that we tend to put in the West on religion.
Yeah, and so much of the frustration I experience, I'm going to check that book out, because when talking to people about Paleolithic and Neolithic religion, is I get this kind of brick wall of skepticism that says these images in Chauvet, we can't really speak too much to this, to their spiritual nature or how they functioned as religious images to those communities, because they don't have an accompanying text.
Right.
And I say, of course they don't have an accompanying text. These are preliterate people, or more correctly, the images are the text.
That's right. That's the way to put it, I think. Uh-huh.
And, you know, what fascinates me, I actually have a question for you about the video that was circulating, because like you said, we can't really learn everything we need to learn about primate behavior from Facebook videos. But having said that, there was a video circulating a while back with an accompanying story about some observations that were made by some scientific teams looking at what they were saying might be evidence of chimpanzee ritual with the throwing of rocks at these hollowed out trees.
Yes, I wrote about that for The Atlantic, as a matter of fact. And I think the paper, original paper, which was by 80 authors, and it discussed chimpanzee behavior at four West African sites. Mm-hmm. And these chimpanzees would reuse the same rocks and hurl them over and over again at the same trees. Was good science. It was not, you know, wildly speculative. They did make the point that there might be superficial similarity to what some West African indigenous people do at sacred shrines. So, in other words, they were trying to figure out what's going on. Why are the chimps doing this over and over again? Did it have to do with male display, or did it have to do with something that was a little bit less material-oriented, and that's why they brought in the possible comparison with sacred shrines? Well, then one of the 80 people who wrote the article did some blog posts. Her name was Laura Kehoe, suggesting full stop, that this is chimpanzee sacred behavior. And that is what sort of set off this whole chain of events of people talking much more about chimpanzee spirituality. I do have a bit of a problem moving from what is very tantalizing clues of potential ritual to putting an overlay of the sacred on top of it, because to me that seems very anthropocentric. I mean, it's how we might think. We create meaning in many societies around gods, or God, you know, however, but why would we necessarily expect the chimpanzee mind to go in that direction? And I'm as fascinated with that argument for its anthropocentrism as I am for its, you know, its other worth.
Yeah, you know what that reminds me of is another video that was circulating the internet recently. And then I have another question for you about Evolving God. And then before we wrap up, I want to ask you about the new book as well. I so appreciate you taking the time with us. But that video about Coco the gorilla, the signing about climate change and the problematic notion there, as compelling as that is. And I have to confess, when I saw it, I was very moved by it as well. For the audience who doesn't know, there was a video circulating that apparently Coco, this gorilla that was taught sign, was told about, you know, from the folks that work with it, about climate change and about what was happening to the planet, about man-made climate change, and then Coco had a response, and they filmed that response and have been showing it at like international climate meetings, and it was making it the rounds on the internet. But some folks criticize that, and I was wondering if maybe you can speak to that as being the same kind of thing, that we're a little bit of anthropomorphizing going on here, because Coco only knows the things about things like this that Coco's handlers are telling Coco, and so there, what's happening there is more just a repetition than actual critical dialogue. Or is that how you would think, what you would characterize
it? Yeah, and excuse me for being scathing, but Coco was absolutely scripted. She was filmed. This was a publicity stunt and a manipulation. I am not a fan. I'm a fan of Coco.
Yeah.
I think Coco is a very, very intelligent gorilla, and I think that she uses some signs of American Sign Language quite facilely. She, of course, doesn't know American Sign Language any more than she knows German or Mandarin,
right,
as a full language. But, you know, she does things as a gorilla that are quite fascinating. Having her filmed in front of a screen while different strings of gestures are cobbled together to make a statement about climate change makes no sense. Gorillas, no matter how smart they are, cannot grasp climate change, period.
Right, yeah, and I think that I'm glad you have the opportunity to speak to that, because I think well-meaning people sometimes use these gimmicks that end up doing more harm than good. Not only is that, as you just said, exploitation of the animal, but it ends up watering down what is otherwise a very serious message and turning it into a trained monkey show.
Yeah, literally trained ape show. Couldn't say it better.
Yeah. So another question about evolving God. Are you familiar with the Benedictine monk David Stendhal Rost?
I'm not.
He's a fascinating guy, and he's a Benedictine. He's a contemplative monk, but he's devoted himself for the past 20 years or so to interfaith dialogue. And what I love about that is he's a kind of contemporary and colleague of Karen Armstrong, who in Evolving God you speak to as being very influential in you developing this kind of operational understanding of religion that you could then use as an overlay to start talking about it in terms of its biological components within primates. And what so many people, when they go to an understanding of religion or to talk about religion, get hung up in are the specifics of one religion to another. And so some religions believe in an actual all-powerful, unified, singular deity. Others believe in a multiplicity of deities. Others believe in one deity that expresses itself through a multiplicity. Others believe in no deity whatsoever, as in Buddhist traditions and other contemplative traditions. Others, like Hindus, believe in a single god that expresses itself in multiple forms that is also not a god at all. Right? And so we have a great deal of diversity and complexity across what we would call religion. And so to try to corral all of that into something that we could have a single understanding of has been a difficult thing to do. But folks like Joseph Campbell, folks like Karen Armstrong, folks like David Stendhal Rost have done it. And they've provided us with different models for this. But basically what they're doing is pointing to what amounts to the mystical awareness that happens in any religion. If you look at Jewish, Christian, or Muslim fundamentalists, they all seem like very different kinds of people with very different kinds of agendas and worldviews. But if you talk to Jewish, Christian, and Muslim mystics, you almost wouldn't be able to tell them apart. And what David Stendhal Rost says is that the religious impulse, religion comes from the Latin religio, which means to tie together or to tie back. The notion is that there's a cord that has been ruptured, and what religion does is it reconnects it. And what Stendhal Ross says is, in his study of all of the world's wisdom traditions and all the world's religions, he can boil them all down to these templates to help us navigate these impulses of belonging and longing.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. He says we bounce back and forth between these two ideas, and that our need to belong, immediate belonging, and then out in concentric circles as our awareness raises, is a profound driver in the development of our religious ideas. But conversely, we all have within us too an evolutionary drive, a longing, a striving for higher self, a striving for moving the self forward, moving the species forward. And so another component of our religious capacity is the longing. Right. And so, but we can't just be longing creatures, because we'll burn ourselves out. We also have to belong at times. But then that belonging has to be tempered with a sense of longing. And you go, I mean, this is the active versus the passive impulse that we see in yin yang. In any of the traditions we go to, we see this. And so what I'm fascinated with is that you settled on this notion of belonging, because in my study of the contemplative traditions, this is absolutely where they settle as well. In bhakti yoga, the Hindu notion of the love of God being that which is the source of all wisdom and all knowledge and all action, it's this love of God as other, this longing for God, that it drives one into the spiritual practice. But as one is in the practice, one is filled with an increasing sense of belonging. As one draws closer and closer to the divine, one starts to intertwine with it, and the two become indistinguishable. And then one feels a profound sense of belonging in the presence of the divine, and that's the mystical awareness. And so all of my research in the nature and of religion speaks directly to what the premise in your book is. I don't know if there's a question in that, but wonder if you can maybe speak to how you came to that in your own study of religious thinkers. How did you come to folks like Karen Armstrong?
Well, first of all, clearly I need to be reading the person that you're describing. And I think for me, the idea of this that you've just described as a sort of co-creation and the back and forth between longing and belonging in the way that sort of I think of it came out of both Armstrong and also a lot of Martin Buber reading Thou. And I became fascinated by what you were talking about, is stripping away sort of the very many differences across different religious traditions and looking at that active phase. You know, what does it mean to do religion, not just to read religion or be religious? And I think I came to it from that point, because of course that's where I have to come from it. If I'm talking about animals whom I can't interview, who have no text, who can't verbalize to me, sure. And the same for, you know, our hominid ancestors, I have to look at action and choice and behavior. It may be reflected in material culture in other ways, but it's all about action. And so the work of these thinkers spoke to me in a way that I just mentioned Donovan Schaefer's book speaks to me too. Not so much the chimpanzee part, but the part we talked about of moving away from this constant focus on textual interpretation. It's also very interesting to me as an atheist to think about belonging and longing, and to think about, I liked how you were describing, reflecting other thinkers, the idea that we all have a desire to sort of move the self forward. And I liked that because I think it's a very inclusive sort of notion that includes agnostics and includes atheists. And writing this material as an atheist is quite an interesting exercise.
It warms my heart to hear you say that, because what drew me to the Paleolithic work and the Neolithic stuff, and maybe we'll just mention this and then I'll ask you a question about your new book and we can wrap up. And I've spoken about this before, is the lack of differentiation in that. And what I mean by that is when we go to the Paleolithic and we see this cave art, we, you know, say in Chauvet, or now there's a cave in Indonesia in Sulawesi that's 40,000 years. It's actually earlier. Yes, we had tribal affiliations at this point. Yes, people had, you know, sort of loose, you know, tribal and familial affiliations, but we hadn't differentiated as a species to the point we have now. We weren't German or French or British. We weren't Jew, Christian, or Muslim. We weren't conservative or liberal. You know, all of these labels that we now lay upon ourselves that hit us from birth, including these gender labels, most of those didn't exist. And so all religious art that's existed for the past, you know, 3,000 years exists as part of this great experiment in differentiation. But the art of the Paleolithic rightly and actually belongs as part of the mythological heritage and inheritance of every person on the planet. Right. It belongs to every one of us equally. And as such, I think it speaks to something very profound. And what it does, I think, and what I think your work and the work of others, including people like Jeremy Rifkin and some of the folks you've mentioned, is it talks about religion and the religious impulse in a way that doesn't have this in-group, out-group. It doesn't focus on, you know, on belief and on the actual existence or non-existence of supernatural powers and on conversion and forgiveness and hell and heaven and all these kinds of structures that we've been focused on for a while. But instead, as I said, religion seen as an algorithm for accessing and expanding symbolic consciousness. In your book, you talk about the importance of narrative, of storytelling, and I couldn't agree more. I think what these impulses lead to is the generation of narrative scripts for healing, for presence, for belonging, and ultimately for transformation, for stories that help us navigate those experiences. And the idea that humans, we know for sure that we are a storytelling creature, and this is a profound component of our identity. But I think what we're starting to learn is that we share the planet with some other storytelling creatures. I was just reading recently about how crows will tell each other stories and actually inform each other on people in the neighborhood who are nice versus ones who aren't, and all this kind of stuff. And you know, all the work that's been done over the years on whale song and stuff, and how we share the planet with other storytelling creatures who are meaning makers as well. And I think, go ahead.
No, I want to underscore that because some of the books that I've been reading recently, John Marsloff on corvids, you just mentioned his work on crows recognizing faces of good and bad people, or Cultural Lives of Whales and Dolphins, fascinating book from University of Chicago Press. They tell us about the cultures of the oceans. And we, when some of my astrophysicists or astronomer friends ask the question, you know, are we alone in the universe? I intellectually totally resonate with that. I want to know about, you know, who's out there in the rest of the world. But I always want to say to them, no, we're not alone in the universe. Look around you.
Yeah.
All of these, we are walking with sentient creatures and swimming with them and flying with them. They're here.
Ones that we haven't wiped from the planet yet.
Well, that is, of course, true. Yes.
Unfortunately. Wow. I so appreciate you being with us. Just two more questions as we wrap up here. One more comment. When you were talking about Göbekli Tepe earlier, I think, again, one of the fascinating things here, and we're just really getting into this place and being able to study it. We have a little more information about Shatil Hayek. But what's fascinating here is several things. One is you know, again, one of the world's first temple spaces. It's, you know, it's being called the first, but, you know, it's first discovered. And there's some discrepancy there. But nonetheless, quite early, right, 10, 11,000 years back, and evidence not only of pretty high material culture but of cooperation. This is pre-civilization, but we have here is a strong connection again to the sacred feminine, and whatever that means, again, we're moving away from that binary or that gender essentialism we were talking about before. At least there is an awareness that the sacred manifests in fluidity. That, you know, it's not a sacred feminine any more than it is a sacred masculine, but that this is able to manifest not in a gendered hierarchy that must be mirrored in our species. Right. So, again, it speaks to what you were saying before about the bonobo realization. As we go back in time, we are seeing, you know, patriarchal religion after patriarchal religion after patriarchal religion. And so then we start to think, oh, this is the nature of our species. And this speaks to something innate in who we are. But the discovery of places like Göbekli Tepe really is akin to the discovery of the bonobos. It goes, hang on, we don't have a single story here anymore.
Yeah, so that how we tell our stories matters, and we need to be thinking about multiple threads of our narrative in just the way that you're describing.
Absolutely, 100%. Okay, so last question before we let you go about the new book, Personalities on the Plate, The Lives and Minds of Animals We Eat. That's scheduled for April 2017?
That's right.
University of Chicago Press. And so, I mean, from the title, it seems pretty clear that what the book is about. But it's about expanding our awareness again, not only in the last book was about animal grief, but this in particular about animals, the ones that we eat. So you're talking about cows, pigs, chickens.
Yeah, and, you know, for this book, I ate some insects, I held a chicken for the first time, I visited some octopus, and I really wanted to think again broadly. So, yes, there are farmed animals in the book, and I talk about symbol smart pigs and emotional chickens, but I also talk about some species that maybe we wouldn't expect, and I've become very cephalopod focused, the octopus and cuttlefish and squid. Just learning about their behaviors was very fascinating for me. And just, you know, again, taking all this information that we're learning about how animals think and feel, and not saying in the book, okay, everybody needs to stop eating meat and stop drinking milk and stop eating eggs. It's not a prescriptive book by any means. I am not myself a vegan, although I eat very many vegan meals, but rather to say, let's think about who we're eating. Let's know who we're eating and look at who we're eating so that we can make decisions. And I had a lot of fun writing the book because it just caused me to delve even more deeply into aspects of animal thinking and feeling that I hadn't known about.
You know, when I'm reminded of is the sort of old world hunter mentality that exists among hunter-gatherer societies and among many indigenous cultures of the kind of sacred act of killing and of the thanking of the animal of giving up its spirit. And that might seem sort of archaic or you know, primitive, quote unquote, to many of us. But I think what that comes along with is the awareness you're talking about that we've lost here.
Yes, and I don't want to denigrate anyone's sacred practice, but I will say that when morphed into modern times by modern hunters, I am pretty disgusted by the idea that, you know, people go out and say, thank you for, you know, letting me take your life, because to me that's not awareness at all. That's not thinking about the issues. And it doesn't help the animal a whole lot at all who's killed, you know, that you're thanking them for their life. So I guess I am fairly militant on this point that the whole question of whether there is or isn't humane slaughter even is very important. But, you know, maybe another conversation.
Yeah. I mean, we're at the end of our time, and I think you make a very good point at the end there, but that simply saying a couple of words over the carcass of an animal that you just, you know, blew its brains out doesn't really get you out of the woods morally at all, and it doesn't get you to the awareness that you're speaking of in either of the two books that you're talking about. So I think that's fairly said. Barbara, we really appreciate you being on the show. Thank you so much for being with us.
I had a really good time talking with you, Andy. Thank you.
Our guest has been Barbara J. King, the anthropologist. We will have links to her work, her website, and all of her books, and the book that's coming out, and her stuff on NPR on our site on the page. We appreciate you being here, Barbara. Folks, this is Andy Gervich. You've been listening to On the Block Radio, and we will see you on the other side.
You've been listening to On the Block. Of all of the voices in your head, thanks for making ours one of them.
A murder of crows. An appropriate name considering these birds' special relationship with death. It's not because they're killers or because they'll sometimes scavenge the bodies of the recently departed. When one of their own dies, crows will surround and call to the dead. In one experiment, scientists holding taxidermied birds approached crows and were viciously attacked. Of course, the creepy masks didn't help. Crows hold funerals, which also explains the black clothing.
And now his watch is ended.
We also congregate around those we've lost to remember them, to console each other in times of sadness and in grief. But are we the only creatures who experience these emotions? Do animals mourn their dead? Dying is a fact of life. It's true for everything that's ever been born. And it's not a pretty thought.
After you die, your cells burst open, insects lay eggs in your body, and bacteria turn you into a putrefaction soup.
Thanks, Anna. That was gross. But being intelligent means that we understand a lot about how death happens, not to mention that it will one day happen to us.
Thinking about mortality can influence our behavior. Humans are curious, anxious, and even frightened about death. A side effect of our intelligence is that we can picture the future, and ourselves and our loved ones won't be a part of it.
Well, that's a cheery thought, Vanessa. For a long time, scientists assumed that grief was unique to humans, but observing certain animals is making us think again. Eleanor was an elephant. Sick and injured, she fell behind her herd and collapsed. Scientists watched as another elephant named Grace ran to her side and tried to lift her up. Sadly, she couldn't. Eleanor died. Over the next several days, her body was visited by 5 different groups of elephants, some completely unrelated to her. They circled the body, caressing it with their feet and trunks, never out of sight, even when lions and hyenas moved in. That's a sad story. To us, anyway. Scientists agree that animals have emotions, but forcing human experiences upon them is anthropomorphism. When elephants and crows hold funerals, are we forcing human emotions onto the lives of animals, or are they truly experiencing grief? Animal researcher Barbara J. King says that grief is a change in an animal's behavior in response to death. They might shift their daily routines, adopt different body language, eat or sleep less, or even put themselves in greater danger to predators. It seems that the elephants were grieving.
Other intelligent animals experience grief in similar ways. Entire troops of chimpanzees will gather around and protect their dead. Mothers will even carry lifeless infants around for days or weeks.
scientists also noticed a group of dolphins gathering around a dead calf, refusing to eat for days and guarding the body even after it started to decay.
Many scientists are now certain that grieving isn't something that we do and animals don't. It's just that ours is more complex. There are many things that humans do that are unique among animals, but many things aren't. Projecting our emotions onto other creatures is a bad habit, but we can be sure that animals have emotions of their own. These animals are deeply moved by grief. Some, like the crows, may use their death rituals to learn about death, but for others, there seems to be something more. Many animals are social. They develop relationships and experience positive emotions from their families and friends. Maybe not happiness or love, but something. Animal mourning might stem from these memories, from realizing what is missing. And we can all relate to that. Stay curious.
You've been listening to On the Block Radio with Andrew Gurevich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Moving the Mountain. Closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Oh, you're beautiful, kitty kitties. Oh, look at you out there. Beauty like a bolt, light in a darkened hallway. New minds looking at this world, at our lives, through the perspective of apocalypse children. Standing dusty in the barren highways, standing broken before the fathers who are meant to make us whole, but who only lied to us about what it meant to be a man, about what it meant to be a woman.